From ICU antidote to COVID disruptor, meet NAC. N-acetylcysteine, or NAC, isn't just for paracetamol overdoses. It's showing promise in treating viral infections, calming inflammation, and protecting DNA. This episode looks at how a cheap, widely available compound is quietly changing the way we manage everything from liver failure to long COVID. NAC is a modified version of the amino acid cysteine. You'll find it in hospital emergency rooms, respiratory clinics, and increasingly in research labs looking at viral infections and aging. At the molecular level, NAC is a precursor to glutathione, your body's main antioxidant. Glutathione is the chemical that helps detoxify reactive oxygen species, or ROS, which are generated during infection, pollution exposure, or even hard exercise. Without cysteine, glutathione production slows down. NAC fills that gap by supplying cysteine in a stable, bioavailable form. It also has a unique chemical group, a sulfhydryl, SSH, group. This allows it to break disulfide bonds. Those are the links that give some proteins their shape and stability. That's why NAC can thin mucus in the lungs and also destabilize viral spike proteins, which we'll come back to. Beyond that, NAC converts into hydrogen sulfide and sulfane sulfur species in the body. These byproducts help control mitochondrial function, modulate inflammation, and improve cell survival under stress. One example, hydrogen sulfide dampens the NLRP3 inflammasome, a key trigger of cytokine storms in severe infections. So NAC isn't just an antioxidant, it's a redox regulator, a signaling molecule, and a structural disruptor, all in one. Let's go to the ER. A young adult comes in after taking too many paracetamol tablets. Her blood tests show high levels of liver enzymes, and she's starting to feel nauseated and weak. This is a medical emergency. Paracetamol is metabolized into a toxic compound called NAPC. Normally, the liver neutralizes NAPC using glutathione. But in overdoses, glutathione gets overwhelmed. The toxic compound builds up and starts damaging liver cells. If NAC is given within 8 to 10 hours of ingestion, it prevents this damage by boosting glutathione production. The standard intravenous protocol starts with 150 mg per kilogram over 1 hour, then a maintenance dose over the next 20 hours. It works. Studies show this can drop mortality in acute liver failure from 58% to around 37%. It can also help patients avoid liver transplantation altogether. NAC is also used orally when IV access is delayed or unavailable. Oral formulations aren't as well tolerated due to taste and side effects, but they're still effective. This remains the textbook case for NAC, fast, targeted, and life-saving. But liver protection isn't limited to emergencies. NAC is being studied in chronic liver conditions, especially non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, NAFLD. In one three-month study, patients taking 600 mg of NAC twice daily had lower ALT levels and reduced liver fat on imaging. The mechanism? NAC likely reduces oxidative stress and suppresses inflammatory cytokines like IL-6 and TNF-alpha. In alcoholic hepatitis, though, the story is more complicated. High-dose NAC, up to 300 mg per kilogram intravenously, didn't improve long-term survival in one major trial. It may help when combined with steroids in early stages, but shows little benefit on its own in late-stage disease. What does that tell us? Timing matters. NAC works best as a preventative or early intervention, not a last-ditch treatment. One of NAC's oldest roles is in the treatment of chronic lung disease. Think COPD, cystic fibrosis, asthma, and bronchiectasis. Its main job? Thinning mucus. Mucin, the protein that gives mucus its thickness, is held together by disulfide bonds. NAC breaks those bonds, making mucus easier to cough up. But NAC also reduces inflammation in the airways. It blocks NF-kB, a key transcription factor that activates inflammatory genes. This leads to less IL-8, less MMP-9, and less airway remodeling. In COPD, this matters. A 600 mg daily dose of inhaled NAC can reduce flare-ups by about 22%. Higher doses, up to 1,200 mg per day, are used in some studies, especially during winter months when exacerbations spike. In asthma, NAC may reduce bronchial hyperreactivity, although results are mixed. It's not a replacement for corticosteroids, but it may help in severe steroid-resistant cases. In cystic fibrosis, inhaled NAC has been shown to improve sputum clearance and lung function scores. It's also being tested in combination with antibiotics to see if it can enhance bacterial clearance. Now let's get into NAC's rising fame, its antiviral effects, especially against SARS-CoV-2. Here's the short version. The coronavirus spike protein needs a specific 3D shape to bind to human cells via the ACE2 receptor. That shape is maintained by disulfide bonds, particularly between two cysteine residues, cis-391 and cis-525. NAC breaks that bond. When the bond is broken, the spike protein partially collapses, reducing its ability to dock onto the ACE2 receptor. Computer models show a threefold drop in binding strength when NAC binds to the cis-525 site. Lab studies using Vero-E6 cells, commonly used to test viral replication, show a 54% reduction in viral replication after NAC treatment. In real-world patients, the data is even more compelling. A 2023 meta-analysis of over 20,000 COVID-19 patients found that NAC reduced mortality by 35%, lowered CRP levels, and improved oxygenation. Another study in ICU patients showed that those receiving IV NAC were taken off ventilators faster. What's driving these effects? Likely a combination: spike protein disruption, antioxidant effects, and reduced cytokine storm via NLRP3 inflammasome suppression. Still, timing is everything. NAC appears most effective when used early, within 48 hours of infection. Late-stage disease, where damage is already done, responds less to antioxidant therapy. Oxidative stress doesn't just affect acute infections. It accelerates aging and increases the risk of chronic disease. NAC helps here too. By replenishing glutathione and scavenging free radicals, it protects DNA from damage. In radiation and chemotherapy models, NAC has been shown to reduce DNA strand breaks and oxidative lesions. But there's also a subtler effect on gene regulation. NAC appears to stabilize epigenetic markers like DNA methylation and histone acetylation. These are the mechanisms that turn genes on and off. When redox balance is disturbed, these patterns become unstable, contributing to cancer, neurodegeneration, and accelerated aging. So NAC may not just extend cell life, it could also help maintain cell identity. Let's talk safety. NAC has been used for decades and has a solid safety profile. Common side effects include nausea and mild gastrointestinal upset, especially with oral formulations. Rarely, IV NAC can cause allergic reactions, usually mild and manageable with antihistamines. Dosing depends on the use. For acetaminophen overdose, it's high and fast, up to 150 mg per kilogram IV. For chronic use in respiratory disease or liver support, doses range from 600 to 1800 mg per day orally. One twist: NAC's status as a supplement is under debate in the US. The FDA temporarily removed it from supplement shelves in 2020, arguing it was approved as a drug first. Legal challenges followed. For now, NAC is still widely available in pharmacies and online. So what's next for NAC? Long COVID is one major frontier. Many patients show signs of ongoing inflammation, oxidative stress, and leftover spike protein fragments. NAC could target all three. There's also interest in using NAC with other agents. One combo, NAC and bromelain, has shown synergistic effects in reducing viral load and cytokine production. Another, NAC plus remdesivir, may improve antiviral effectiveness by reducing oxidative stress, which viruses exploit to replicate. Delivery methods are evolving too. Researchers are exploring nanoparticle formulations of NAC that could cross the blood-brain barrier or deliver it more directly to inflamed tissues. This could open doors in neurodegenerative diseases like Parkinson's and Alzheimer's. From detoxifying the liver to disabling the spike protein of SARS-CoV-2, N-acetylcysteine proves that an old drug can still have new tricks. With a strong safety record and growing research base, NAC stands out as one of the most versatile tools in modern therapeutics. At MedHeads, we bring you expert-led content to help you stay ahead in medicine and healthcare. If that's useful to you, please subscribe. We've got more coming your way every week.